Hello everyone! This chapter is going to be all about the central nervous system. So just to remind you about the language that we use here, when we say central nervous system, we're talking about the parts of the nervous system that are very central in the body. So we're talking about the head, the brain, and the spinal cord. So things that are right down the center plane of the body. We're not going to be considering at this point the peripheral nervous system, which would include the neurons that branch off and innervate other regions of the body. We're just going to be looking at the central nervous system for right now. So we're going to start off right from the very beginning. Where does the central nervous system actually come from? This is something that we can see really, really early on in embryonic development. If we were to look at an embryo, what we would see is three very distinct layers. This is something that you may or may not know depending on how much biology you've had before this class. But in embryonic development, there are what are called three different germ layers. Here they are: ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm. Endoderm, this is the innermost layer that becomes the gut lining. Mesoderm, this becomes a lot of our different organ systems. Our focus right now is going to be on ectoderm. Ectoderm is the outermost layer of an embryo, and this is what will develop into the epidermis and also the nerve tissue. So we're here to talk about nerve tissue. So that's where we're going to be at today. So looking at that outermost layer, again, this is very early on, just 20 days after conception, we can already see the nervous system developing in an embryo. So 20 days after conception, if we were to look at an embryo, what we would see is some really distinctive structures. So we're going to be looking at three different cross sections here of this embryo. By the way, this is the head end, this would be the tail end over here. And in cross-section, we can see very clearly right here is what's called a neural groove. And parked on top of that is what we call a neural crest. Let's come down to this lower cross-section. So the groove kind of fully encloses into a tube down here in this region. So there it is, there's the tube. That's called the neural tube. That is what's going to develop into the central nervous system. Parked right on top of it is the neural crest, and that neural crest will become the peripheral nervous system. So we can see these two different divisions, central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system, very distinct, like really early on, 20 days after conception. If we go forward just a little bit in time to 4 weeks after conception, what we will start to see on this neural tube is that there will be really distinctive swellings. There will be three distinct swellings. So let's take a look at that. The prosencephalon, the mesencephalon, and the rhomboencephalon. And these are going to become the different major regions of the brain. So as we go forward, we will be talking about the forebrain, the midbrain, and the hindbrain. We'll tend to use those slightly more common terms. And again, just keep in mind, these are all set in place very early on. Going forward, just one more week, so 5 weeks, by week five, we've developed some additional swellings. So the forebrain ends up sort of splitting into different regions. We have a telencephalon and a diencephalon. The telencephalon is what will become the cerebral hemispheres, and we're kind of mentioning all of this in passing right now. Most of this chapter is going to be focused on in the adult brain, different regions of the adult brain. So in the adult brain, okay, these are the different major regions that we'll be talking about. We'll start with the cerebral hemispheres, then we'll move down to the thalamus and hypothalamus, which are all part of the diencephalon, and then we'll just kind of work our way down here, and we'll talk about what each of these regions do. One interesting thing about that neural tube that we mentioned on the previous slide, I'll just back up for a second. So this neural tube right here, in embryonic development, you can see that it's hollow. It actually stays hollow all the way into adulthood. And that hollow cavity is going to become what we would call the ventricles and the central canal of the nervous system. So the ventricles of the brain, these are the spaces essentially in the brain. These are spaces that have cerebrospinal fluid, and the central canal is just the hollow core of the spinal cord, and it also has cerebrospinal fluid. So looking at in an adult brain what these ventricles look like, here's sort of a map of them. The ventricles are shown in blue, so these are the open spaces in the brain that have the cerebrospinal fluid. And the brain is a really amazing organ. It's also an organ that requires a lot of energy and a lot of maintenance in order to maintain. So just in terms of blood flow, just to kind of give you an idea, how much does it take to maintain a full-grown brain? In general, for adults, about 15% of our blood flow goes to the brain per minute. So that's a good portion of our blood flow right there. The brain has really high metabolic requirements. It needs a lot of glucose in order to do all of the things that it does. And it does this very efficiently. The brain, if you were to guess, I'll give you a second to think, how much does the brain weigh? Just in an adult, think about the size of the brain, how much does it weigh? It only weighs about 3 pounds, 3 to 3.5 pounds. That being said, it has a lot of cells packed into that space. There are about 100 billion neurons that make up the brain, so a huge number of cells all working together to fulfill these functions. The cerebrospinal fluid that is present in the ventricles, this is very important for helping to maintain the health of all of these neurons. And this is a fluid that is produced by certain cells. So we'll see a little bit later on, we're gonna see a region that'll be labeled the choroid plexus. This is a major region that is producing cerebrospinal fluid. And then that fluid can flow through the different ventricles of the brain. There is an exchange between cerebrospinal fluid and the blood, blood that flows through the brain in capillaries. So there's an exchange that goes on there. In general, we usually make about half a liter or 500 milliliters of cerebrospinal fluid per day. And that's just to maintain the normal volume of cerebrospinal fluid. So some of the fluid is being absorbed back into the bloodstream. Meanwhile, we're making new cerebrospinal fluid to replace it. I'd like to just point out, before we move on from this, I'd like to point out some of the different regions that are come up. So regions that are going to come up. So choroid plexus, this one is pretty much right in the center of the brain. Let's come up to this view right here. So choroid plexus is kind of right in the central region. And you'll notice right here is a label, the third ventricle. This is the space, again, shown in blue, the space that exists right around that choroid plexus. We'll see this more as we go forward, but the third ventricle, this is kind of like the first region that the cerebrospinal fluid would flow into, and then from there it can get to all sorts of places. These ventricles are interconnected, so it can travel out to the sides. These are called the lateral ventricles. Lateral means to the side, so it makes sense to call these lateral ventricles. And then there's also a connection down to the lower regions. Down here would be the fourth ventricle. And this is going to lead to the central canal in the spinal cord. So there's this continual flow that can happen in order to transport substances through the different regions of the central nervous system.